Some of the families of the victims of the bloody war on drugs received the urns of their loved ones. Adrian Aileen joins us to tell us more. Adrian, go ahead.
Yes, Stanley, six urns containing the cremated remains of victims of the war on drugs were turned over to their families this morning at the Sacred Heart Parish Church by Program Paghilom, led by Father Flavio Villanueva. Before the urns were turned over, prayers were offered by Father Villanueva for the victims, namely Jaime Alcober, Genersiso Amper, Erwin Garzon, Florencio Tion, Jean Paul Barros, and Pablo Cabangon. The six victims belong to the 12th batch of exhumations and cremation under Program Paghilom. Father Flavi also said all victims of the war on drugs under Program Paghilom will be laid to rest in a space being prepared at the La Loma Cemetery. In a short program, the families expressed gratitude to Program Paghilom as their fathers and brothers will finally be afforded a more decent burial. Netherlands Ambassador Marielle Gerads assisted during the handover of the urns to the families. She assured the families that the Netherlands is monitoring developments in the country and continues its call on the Philippine government to ensure that justice and accountability will be achieved. Back to you, Stanley.
All right. Thank you so much for that, Adrian Aileen. Five policemen in Cebu have been charged over the alleged kidnapping and rape of a drug suspect. Annie Perez joins us with details. Annie, go ahead.
Yes, Stanley, the National Bureau of Investigation in Central Visayas filed administrative and criminal cases before the Visayas Ombudsman versus five cops assigned in Cebu City. They were policemen assigned at Station 11 and identified as follows: Police Corporal John Robert Rebusa, Police Corporal Jeffrey Alabata, Police Corporal Kevin Hilbuena, and Police Staff Sergeant Donald Balansang, and a certain Luis, who is said to be also part of their service. The NBI based their charges from a complaint from a female client alleging that sometime in September 2022, these policemen barged into her friend's house claiming a drug arrest while firing a gun into the air. The victim also said that she was forced to be on board a motor vehicle and then was brought to a two-story apartment where she was blindfolded, cuffed, and forced to use illegal drugs. There was also an instance where in the 3 days that she was held captive, that she was raped by one of the captors. She was released 3 days after and was told by those who caught her to keep in touch with them and was also given a cell phone. Now, the Cebu City Police Office and the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency denied that there was a drug operation on the day of the incident, and that NBI further said that the act of those involved was illegal and unauthorized, and they acted upon on their personal and private capacity. They were charged with violations of serious illegal detention with rape, the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act, and conduct prejudicial to the best interest of service. Meanwhile, the Police Regional Office in Central Visayas confirmed the assignment of these men and said that they will look into the matter. In fact, the identified cops are now relieved from their posts pending investigation. And that's the latest here from Central Visayas. Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
Thank you so much for the update, Annie Perez. Now, visitation is again allowed at the new Bilibid Prisons and Correctional Institute for Women. It was suspended for more than 2 weeks due to an uptick in COVID cases among persons deprived of liberty. Authorities say both facilities are now free from COVID, but visitors will still be required to observe minimum health protocols. The Bureau of Corrections says visitors at the NBP will also need to take a rapid antigen test prior to their scheduled visit. The Bureau of Internal Revenue has filed criminal charges against illicit tobacco traders in the country. Jeff Neanias joins us with that story. Over to you, Jeffrey.
Hi, Stanley. The Bureau of Internal Revenue, led by Commissioner Romeo Lomagi Jr., has filed criminal complaints against smugglers and traders allegedly behind the illicit tobacco trades across the country. 69 criminal cases for tax evasion were filed against the possessors and owners of the cigarette stores and warehouses. Lomagi says the identification of those behind the illicit tobacco trades was the result of the simultaneous nationwide raids conducted last January 25 in provinces and cities and municipalities across the country. During the raid, the BIR was able to confiscate and tax fake and smuggled cigarettes, which cost the government 1.8 billion pesos in taxes. Many came from Zamboanga City and Pampanga, which Lumagi says are considered the hot spots of the illegal trade. The illicit tobacco trade, Stanley, the BIR says, cost the government an estimated 50 to 100 billion pesos in tax revenues annually.
Ito ngayon, itong mga nahuli natin nung nakaraang January 25 na rin ay yung iba dito walang stamp, yung iba dito ay peke ang stamps na kunwari pinapalabas na bayad ang tax pero sa totoo hindi. Kaya na-verify natin yan nung January 25 na peke ang mga stamps na nakalakip dito sa pakete ng mga sigarilyo.
After the filing of the criminal complaints against those behind the illicit tobacco trade, Lumagi says that they will now come after the main source of the smuggled cigarettes with the help of other government agencies. Back to you, Stanley.
All right. Thank you so much for the update, Jeffrey. The Philippines has State Grid operator on the defensive after earning the ire of senators over its unfinished projects. The National Grid Corporation of the Philippines says the projects were delayed due to restrictions posed by the COVID pandemic and right-of-way issues. On Wednesday, Senate probe, the Energy Regulatory Commission said 33 NGCP projects in Luzon, 19 in the Visayas, and 14 in Mindanao all remain unfinished.
COVID happened. That's the reality. Okay. Right-of-way happened. It's a problem. Even government admitted that right-of-way is a difficulty. When asked if it was better for government to handle a right-of-way, I said, you know, if they can do it, that's great. But the problem is, in actuality, the right-of-way that government turned over to us since 2009, up to date, has not been fully settled. We actually have people, landowners from the 70s, complaining they have not been paid. And the difference between government and NGCP is that when we enter, we have to pay the proper compensation to the landowners. That doesn't seem to have been the case because they have not turned us all, the vast majority of our right-of-way has no documentation. And that poses a problem for us because the people are angry at us, thinking that it is us who owe them when actually it was government who entered.
ANC's parent firm, ABS-CBN, sets its sights on an even larger viewership and a return to profitability soon. Jackie Pascual has more on ABS-CBN's annual stockholders meeting.
ABS-CBN held its annual stockholders meeting with company president Carlos Katigvac, saying that ABS-CBN will continue to seek partners as it eyes a bigger audience market than before. Katigvac said the company continues to look for more partners to produce the best programs in all platforms globally, whether on free TV, ATV, or online streaming. He asserted that ABS-CBN will focus on being a storyteller. He also told stockholders that he hopes the company will regain profitability in the near future, saying it will be an uphill climb to profitability. But it has shed off assets that are no longer needed, generating 3 billion pesos income from the sale of properties, which help offset financing costs. Katigvac clarified that there is no deal yet on the redevelopment of the ABS-CBN compound, which circulated online. Revenues are up to 19.2 billion pesos in 2022 from 17.8 billion in 2021. Net loss decreased to 2.6 billion in 2022 from 5.6 billion the previous year. Katigvac also thanks their partners, audiences, employees, and stockholders for the continued trust and support as ABS-CBN eyes to establish itself in the global arena as one of the top storytelling companies.
3 to 5 years. That's how long it will take to rebuild the Manila Central Post Office building, which was ravaged by a massive fire earlier this week. That estimate was given by the Postmaster General as investigators try to determine what caused the blaze and which parts of the historical landmark can still be saved.
We're assuring that it's going to be restored to the for the same structure and the same facade and the same setup.
Siyempre gusto nating isalba yung building, historical yan eh. Kaya lang kung ang mako-compromise naman yung safety ng mga empleyado ng post office, yung mga pumupunta doon, siyempre na gusto natin ma-save. Titingnan natin yung resulta.
for the National Historical Commission of the Philippines, collaboration among government agencies is needed to restore the former glory of the Manila Central Post Office. NHCP Chairman Dr. Emmanuel Franco Calairo says cultural agencies will work together to help in rebuilding efforts and in mitigating disaster risks at heritage sites.
Lahat yun, titignan natin na mabuti. Pero syempre, hintayin natin din yung ating post office to release their own engagement on this, yung kanilang mga pagtataya sa mga nangyari, no? Para at least ay magkaroon ng clear vantage point ang mga cultural agencies kung paano sila tutulong. Yung preventive natin, no? So tingnan natin yung regular assessment ng mga buildings, no? Yung mga architectural designs, so yung mga yeah. Yung mga plants, no, kung it's still viable for its yung maintenance, no, para kung tatagal pa siya, kasi with that little things, no, we could prevent, no, yung mga ganitong klase ng problema.
Bohol Island is nominated as the first Philippine site on UNESCO's list of global geoparks. The list recognizes areas that combine conservation with sustainable development. The UN Cultural Agency highlighted Bohol's scenic and varied landforms and structural features, where it said traces of the island's subterranean past can be found. It also hailed Bohol's diverse flora and fauna, which conserved endemic species. The popular tourist destination, along with 17 other sites, will soon join the Global Geoparks Network, bringing the total number of members to 195 this year.